In progress.
Good morning, and let's begin with a word of prayer. Dear Father in heaven, we invite your Spirit's presence here as we open your word together. As we continue to look at the light that has been coming from your word, from the book of Judges, from Judges 4 and other places, we ask for your direction and guidance in this presentation. Help our minds to understand the things that we are studying. We pray that your Holy Spirit can speak to each heart and bring a conviction and a power in their lives. Be with us now, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Actually, it's not very good, so you should hear me better now.
That's a good pickup on that microphone.
Yeah. I unplug it sometimes because I look on a hard drive and that's where I unplug it. So sometimes forget to plug it back in. Now, we've been studying Judges chapter 4 and we've spent quite a bit of time on it. Now, just the basic idea that we have, which comes from Judges chapter 2, is we came to understand that the book of Judges is dealing with our movement. And Judges 2 shows the history from 9/11 to 2023, which is this crisis that this movement is moving towards. And this is because of the enemies that were not removed, that are put there as to prove us or to test us. And so when we looked at Judges chapter 3, we could see the various judges and the mess and the enemies, and the judges represent messages in response to these enemies. And we see this clearly in Judges chapter 4. And so we had drawn out on a line before, and so we're going to have to do that again, what we see here in the book of Judges. But we would take it that Judges chapter 4 is addressing this history dealing with Parminder. That is the message of Parminder and Tess. So that's the enemy. That's going to be Jabin, the king of Canaan, who is going to be the papacy. And Sisera is his general. So Parminder, I'm not saying Parminder's a Jesuit, but he's definitely doing the work of a Jesuit and has done the work of the Jesuit in this movement. And he's bringing ideas which we would look at as papal ideas. Now, we have some chronological symbols that were here that we looked at, like the 20 years. And we could see that the 20 years addressed a period of time from basically, how did we do that? But we'll look at that. So we're going to look at this 20 years again, which we had addressed before. And then also we have a Barak, who's going to bring an army of 10,000 men. And what tribes are those men from? Because he doesn't bring them from all the tribes of Israel. What tribes is he going to bring these 10,000 men from?
If I remember correctly, it's Zebulun and Naphtali.
Yeah, so Zebulun and Naphtali. And you'd see that in verse 6, right? And, you know, if you're reading it, you might think, well, it's 10,000 from each tribe. I mean, you could get that impression until you read it later, where you can see that it's 10,000 men, and that's in Judges 4, verse 10. And Barak called Zebulun and Naphtali to Kadesh, and he went up with 10,000 men at his feet, and Deborah went up with him. So we take Deborah as representing the movement of FFA, because it's a church, and Barak is representing this message, the message basically of July 18, 2020. But there's going to be a specific part of that message, or in some ways we could even say a specific person that's related to this, which is Heber the Kenite, which was of the children of Hobab, the father-in-law of Moses. He had severed himself from the Kenites and pitched his tent in the plain of Zaanaim, which is by Kadesh. Now, some of these things, they're difficult to explain. That is, I see them because they relate to me personally. That is, when we looked at Judges 4, verse 11, Dwight had mentioned he didn't use the word tent, he used the word home, because that's what the word tent means. But the fact that it was the Hebrew number 168, for me, struck me right away, because I know 168 times 77 is my home address when I grew up as a child. And the word Zaanaim, the gematria for that is 65. So the tent unto the plain of Zaanaim, that's 12936 65 Street, which is where I grew up. So it shows that it's something related to a message that I have specifically given. And that's going to address this error. And to figure out exactly what that is, because here we're not talking about people, we're talking about messages. Now we can see that sometimes the symbols attached to the person giving the message, and that shouldn't surprise us. But what we can't do is we can't say, well, you know, Heber represents Theodore and his wife represents Heidi, so that's Jael. You know, those types of things. That would be a misapplication of Miller's rules. So what we're looking at is we're looking at symbols, and these symbols attach to parts of our message, and especially the chronology. So I would say that, you know, Barak would represent this chronological message, and Heber and Jael represent specifically the message regarding July 18, 2020. Does that seem reasonable to people? Or have I moved way too fast in looking at this?
I think you're going to have a better basis for that.
Okay, so a better basis for
making the application of this as being July 18th.
Okay. Well, so one is we had a bunch of symbols that were attached to this. And so the first thing that we would have to look at is if we're going to go back to these tribes, Naphtali and Zebulun. So let's go there. So this is one of my PowerPoints. Now this goes to Odilio study. So I'd done a presentation on this on Friday. And Odilio had taken this spans of time from the tokens of the earthquake, the dark day, and the falling of the stars, and had looked at those spans of time going to July 18, 2020. Now, and that's where it becomes quite interesting, because I'd already done this study a little bit differently, but I had connected this history to our history already. And that is, I had taken the earthquake and paired it with the earthquake in Japan on March 11th, 2011. Now, 311 is a symbol. It comes from Samuel Snow's letters. It's the publication of his Pentecost letter. But also June 22nd, 2011 is the date that Jeff marked as the start of the School of the Prophets, because he received $165,000 check on that day. So he had marked that, and also June 22nd, 2014, when they have the first camp meeting in Arkansas. So 311 from March 11th to June 22nd, 2011 is 311 days. So this earthquake of Japan is a token of what is to come. That is, it's a token of July 18th. Now, September 11 lines up with the dark day. Now, why would we line up September 11th with the dark day? What are some of the reasonings that we would have there? I mean, because we don't have a dark day on September 11th in that. I mean, we're not looking at these things being literally the same. I mean, even though an earthquake is an earthquake. But it's more the symbols attached with that earthquake that matter. So why would September 11 be a dark day?
Well, there are over 3,000 people killed in Towers 1 and 2. I mean, with all that stuff from those buildings falling, there was a cloud, a very thick cloud of fragments and dust and toxins. I mean, you can look at it that way, but the U.S. was terrified. I mean, the whole world was aghast.
Okay.
When those towers went down.
Okay. But we also know that we attach it to September 11th to the message of the budding trees of spring, right? And that is connected together with the dark day. I'm not going to go through the whole study again on that. And then we have the falling of the stars. So the falling of the stars, November 13th, 1833, those are connected to some degree with William Miller receiving his credentials, correct? So 1833 is not just the falling of the stars as a symbol. It's also connected with Miller. Would we agree with that?
Yes.
Okay. And now I've tied Miller's and mine, our conversions are tied together, which we're going to look at. But August 11th, 1980 is my personal conversion. And that occurred during a falling of the stars. So his was a Leon in 1833. It's a Leonid meteor shower, one of the most spectacular ever. And August 11th, 1980 is a Perseid meteor shower, one of the most spectacular ever recorded. Though I was in the ideal location to witness this, and it's the day of my conversion. And so we would say that, and it happens to be 14,587 days before July 18th, and that 14,587 days is the number of days that the manna fell. So we're taking these things from one from my personal life, which, I mean, obviously other people saw the meteor shower, and then two that are major world events, September 11th and March 11th, 2001 and 2011, that are tokens prior to July 18th. And specifically, we would have to say that these are understood for our movement. And even with the August 11th, 1980, this is during glacier view, and a falling of a star. Would the falling of Desmond Ford represent a falling of a star?
Well, it would, because Ellen White said that many bright lights would go out, would be extinguished.
Yeah.
So there's a symbolism.
Yeah, so there's some symbolism even there. So that would also connect to Adventist history as well. And so these are, and notice, you know, we have some of these, just like in Millerite history, though this is in reverse, but we have some that happen before the time of the end. In this case, we have two, Lisbon and so forth, and then one that happens after the time of the end. And in this case, one happens before the time of the end, 1989. So 1980s before the time of the end, and two happen after. So it's a mirror of this history. When we put the reform line of the Millerites here, you can see that this is a mirror of that. So July 18th becomes this mirror of Millerite history, this history leading up to it. And these tokens then are for this movement as signs. And now I recognize these before July 18, 2020, but that study wasn't really understood or accepted. That is, most people didn't know about the study. So I'd already understood some of this. I didn't understand the 14,587 days, but I did recognize these waymarks. Now, what Odilio had done is he had taken, and this is the key here, is he had taken the tribe of Zebulun. And this was based upon this number down on the bottom, going from November 1st, 1755 to November 13th, 1833, being 28,502 days. And what he did is he took this 28 from the beginning of it, and he then looked for a verse that was chapter 2, verse 8, and that's Numbers 2, verse 8. And so let's go there. Okay, that didn't work. There we go. So in Numbers chapter 2, and in Numbers chapter 1 and Numbers chapter 2 are the numbering of the tribes. For the men who are 20 years old and upwards, so that they can go to war. And, you know, it's going to start with Reuben, and then Simeon, and then Judah. Let me see, where is it going to start here? Reuben, and Simeon, and Judah, and Issachar, and Zebulun, and the sons of Joseph are going to be in Numbers chapter 1, and then in Numbers chapter 2. You're going to continue counting. Where is this here? Mentions one of the captains, and then he's going to count Issachar, Zebulun, etc. So he's going to go through this again. I'm not sure. How does this do this? Anyway, he counts them in Numbers chapter 1 and 2, and I have to go through that in a bit more detail. So he's going to do this counting there. And then later, you know, 39 years later, almost, yeah, well, 38, 39 years later, in Numbers chapter 26, they're also going to count the new generation. So there's two different times that these generations are counted, or the people are counted, two different generations. And these numbers become significant, but it's Numbers chapter 2, verse 8, talking about Zebulun. Then of the tribe of Zebulun, and Eliab the son of Helon shall be captain of the children of Zebulun, and his host, and those that were numbered thereof, were 57,400. So he took this number and he just counted it backwards from July 18th. 2020. So he had already had this date because of these tokens and because of this number. So he felt that he could go back and find a verse in the Bible, and it happened to be Numbers that gave him a number. And so he counted this as the number of days. And so coming to May 23rd, 1863, this is the date. Sometimes this is the date given for the organization of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Sometimes they give May 21st. May 23rd is the last day of the session. So that session is going to end on a Sabbath. So that's why some people give the May 23rd date. But the vote really passes on May 21st, 1863. But he was able to take Zebulun and bring it back to this date. And we would have to say that that's not a coincidence, that he could take one of the tribes and find that the numbering of that tribe is a span of time that connects to July 18th. But we can see that this would be incomplete. And why is it incomplete in our study? What is it that we're, why would we say this is incomplete? We have the tribe of Zebulun going back to the beginning of the Adventist Church. But why would we just say that's incomplete?
there is just the one tribe named, right?
Right. So he just takes Zebulun. But in our study, what have we noticed about this message of July 18th? In Judges chapter 4, if we're going to take that this is about the message of July 18th, Barak has 10,000 soldiers from which tribes?
Zebulun and Naphtali, isn't it?
So it's Zebulun and Naphtali, right? So there's two tribes mentioned here. Now, of course, Odilio's not studying this, so he doesn't know about that we could take these other tribes. But if we're going to look at Zebulun and Naphtali, we're going to have to take that into account, that we should be able to place Naphtali on this line. Now Naphtali has 53,400. And so what I did is I went back from November 13th, 1833, and I counted 53,400 days for Naphtali going forward. And this brings me to 1980. So this is the falling of the stars in 1833, and this is going to be the falling of the stars in 1980. Now, it doesn't bring me all the way back to August 11th, 1980. It brings me back just to January 27th, 1980. So there's 197 days between them. Now, what would be the significance of this? What is it? Do I have a miss or a hit in that sense with Naphtali? Now, Naphtali is also 1,780 prophetic months, and 178 is the number of days from the autumnal equinox to the spring equinox. 187 is from the spring to the fall. Together they make 365. So any significance? Now, Ran, you had a point that you had brought up regarding this. So you're saying that it goes back to 1097 BC, to the anointing of Saul, and that the anointing of Saul in 1097 BC. So 197 is representing the anointing of Saul. And then Saul reigns for how many years? So 40 years. And from 1980 to July 18, 2020 is 40 years. And it's actually here, it's the 40 years of the falling of the manna that's represented. So basically it's 40 years less a month. It's 494 months. And so would there be significance in this symbol here then? The question is, do I have a hit or a miss? It doesn't go to the day, it goes to the year, but it also provides a symbol. Any thoughts on that? First, I really need to know that people are following this well.
It's a struggle, but I can see how it could fit. But now my question is, what occurrence in the mainstream church that was so starkly important happened January 27th? Maybe there was one, maybe there wasn't.
Yeah, maybe there's some event relating to a glacier view that happens on January 27th, 1980. I don't know. But yeah. If we're going to take it as the anointing of Saul, there might be something that happens in 1980 that I haven't marked yet. Now, and it could also be that, some of these spans are just going to give us the year of an event, not necessarily marking the day.
Amen.
Yeah. So, I mean, because one is they're rounded off to hundreds. Now, the other thing is we have this symbol of 10,000, which I'm going to address as well, the 10,000 soldiers. So, because those are going to be from Zebulun and Naphtali. And so there, to me, is a significance that lies in that 10,000. Now, it doesn't say how many of them are from Zebulun and how many of them are from Naphtali. So... So it's something to be considered here. So this study here isn't complete. And one thing I don't address here specifically is all these other little spans of time in between, and there could be significance from November 13th, 1833 to May 23rd, 1863, which is a period of 30 years. And so I'm not sure. I mean, 10,000 is going to be 27 years, but there are some other numbers. So we're going to address this as time goes on. So I haven't sorted everything out. So I'm just showing you some of the preliminary ideas here. And the question is, should we proceed with that? Now, one of the things dealing with Parminder is Parminder, when he comes into the history of this movement, what is it that brings Parminder into this movement, that brings our attention to Parminder? I mean, Parminder had been in the movement prior to 9/11. So Jeff had met him prior to 9/11. So Parminder's been in this movement for a long time. But what is it that and mostly it was his, I mean, we know that he did this series of studies on the 2520, which was in 2010. Some people put it in 2009. But I guess notoriously, what brings Parminder into this movement as one of the enemies? When does his oppression begin? Let's put it that way. Okay, so 2012. Now, I don't have a specific date in 2012. I do know that FFA in 2012, on April 28th, addressed, they did a study, Jeff did a study, and looked at and did a presentation looking at what Parminder had been sharing. Now, I haven't looked up the study. I assume it would be at Lambert Church, so I probably could just look there. So maybe Iran could do a quick check if that's correct. But April 28th, 2012, there's going to be, they're going to address Parminder's error. So one of the ways I know this is an email. Well, it's actually Facebook history. So in trying to research some of this to deal with Parminder, is I had to go back to my old Facebook histories. But on the 2520 discussion group, as it was called there, it's now the 2520 study group, Bronwyn says this: Jason uploaded our Sabbath study sermon this morning, but Jeff has asked him to wait. So this is on May 2nd. Asked him to wait for the other side to finish studying out the implications of the 2014 message before publishing this study to the public forum. When the other side is finished with their consideration, then we'll provide a link. The last week of April 1st, for the last week of April, I considered watch the videos presented by the 2014 group. So she calls this the 2014 group. That is, they're predicting the Sunday law in 2014. This is Parminder's group. She says, on Sabbath, April 28th, it was all put into perspective. I'm hoping Richard Kenny will have the same experience. Thank you for your patience. So I'm actually, this is on a thread, a discussion with a guy named Richard Kenny. So that's actually how I found this discussion, was searching my discussions with Richard Kenny. So he's the one who introduced to me that Parminder was teaching that there's a Sunday law coming. And at that time, Tabo had just moved in April. Tabo had moved in with me. This is before I married Heidi. And yeah, so that's what I thought. Lambert only goes back to 2015. I didn't think it went all the way back there. So I don't know if I tried finding the video. I couldn't find it. But Iran might be able to do that. So anyway, so Jeff did a presentation on April 28th, 2012, addressing this point. So that's the only date I have. I don't have the date that Parminder presented it. I do have the video on YouTube, but it doesn't give the date of the presentation. So anyway, if we go from 2012, we have a period of 25, 20 years that brings us, or 25, 20 years, 25, 20 days, a 7-year period that brings us to 2019 when Parminder leaves the movement. So that's rather interesting. And any questions about any of that? I mean, I know there's still more, so this is kind of incomplete. But the question I'd asked is, what is it that Parminder, or I didn't quite ask it. So in 2012, Parminder is basing his prediction of 2014 based upon what?
What's his own whim, maybe, because I had heard that he had confessed that there was no scriptural basis for what he was presenting.
When did he say that?
I guess it was right around that time. Oh, Iran's got 126 years from 1888. I don't even remember this until somebody mentioned it.
So, I mean, the method is correct. I if he said there was no scriptural basis, this he might have said later, because he's also had rejected all of his arguments for the 25-20 from Leviticus 26. He eventually abandoned that as well. So I'm going to write on the whiteboard. It might be a little bit easier. And I know I get stuff on there already. But I'm going to erase this. Okay, so our movement already had understood that from 1863 to 1989 is a period of 126 years, right? So this was well established.
Right.
Prior to Parminder coming up with his 2014 prediction. And so he used this. So he marked 1888 and then counted to 2014, 126 years. Now, is there a Sunday law in 1888?
There was one that was tried to be passed, the Blair Bill.
What's that?
The Blair Bill.
Okay, so there's the Blair Bill, but there isn't actually ended up being a Sunday law. That Sunday law is thwarted, correct?
Right.
Right. So to predict then a Sunday law in 2014, he would have to say that this Sunday law here would be delayed until 2014.
But the point about that too.
Yeah.
Why was the Sunday law thwarted in 1888?
Well, A.T. Jones presenting before a Senate committee.
Now, let's be direct. A.T. Jones was a historian, correct?
Yeah.
So could we also say that this Sunday law was thwarted by chronology?
Okay.
A different aspect of chronology, but yes, it was, and it's a biblical argument that he presented. I've read his argument of what he presented to the Senate committee and their response.
So what he did is he made use, as Father Miller did, he made use of history along with the Bible to thwart the passage of this bill.
Right. Yeah. Now, we know, of course, he also presented Righteousness by Faith in 1888. Right. That's going to be at the General Conference in November 4th. It's going to end.
Right.
So one thing we can say here, too, is we also have a conference, the General Conference, as we do here, right? So we know that this one was marked by Odilio with this history, right? So, but we know that Parminder's attached to 1888. He's not attached to 1863. I mean, he is, in a sense, because he's going to use both of these. He's going to take the manna as being 60 shekels. And if that's the case, you get 151 years. So he does tie these two together. So in a sense, you can see that these two dates are tied together in Adventist history and in Parminder's prediction, but we already have them tied together. Right? So 60 shekels to a manna gives you 151 shekels, and 50 shekels to a manna gives you 126 shekels. And so these shekels become years. But this is how Parminder comes into this movement as far as becoming this leader. But he comes with this issue dealing with 1888. So I'm going to go back to this chart here.
So when you look at this chart down in the bottom right-hand corner, whoops, I'm going to, I guess that's why. If we take the last day of the General Conference in 1888, and we take the tribe of Reuben. Now, we did this a little bit in our study. Why did we choose Reuben? Why would we choose Reuben to represent Parminder? Think the layout of the tribes of Israel. What's the symbol for Reuben? What's his banner?
The man?
Yeah, a man's head, right? Is that how we understand it? It's man, anyway, whether it's just his head or the whole man. And is Parminder presenting here something that is of man's intellect alone?
We could look at it that way.
Yeah, so if we look at Genesis 49, the blessings that Jacob gives his 12 sons. Reuben is the firstborn. He's going to receive this. And I'm just going to get this. Switch my video. Okay. So you can see that, right? Genesis 49, verse 3. Reuben, thou art my firstborn, my might, and the beginning of my strength, the excellency of dignity, and the excellency of power. Unstable as water, thou shalt not excel, because thou wentest up to thy father's bed, then defilest thou it. He went up to my couch. Now, what is this saying about Reuben? As a symbol. Can we apply this to Parminder?
Definitely.
Okay, can you explain how you would apply it?
at this point, the way that he's approached everything as far as the presentations and the way that he has been attempting to lead people has been a great example of Reuben, unstable as water.
Yeah. But on the surface, he's a leader, right? Parminder was able to take the majority of this movement to follow him. But he's definitely unstable as water. Now, what about this, thou wentest up to thy father's bed, when thou then defilest thou it, he went up to my couch. What is this a reference to?
Repeat, please.
Anybody know?
What is what a reference to? What are you referring to?
Reuben defiling his father's bed.
If you go to Genesis 35:22. And it came to pass when Israel dwelt in that land that Reuben went and lay with Bilhah, his father's concubine, and Israel heard it. Now okay. The sons of Jacob were 12, and then it names them all. So he was a fornicator with his father's concubine.
Yeah. Okay, so. But
is that also not a transgression of the covenant?
Yes, it's a transgression of the covenant. Yeah. It's adultery. We could look at it as spiritual adultery. Does this describe Parminder?
In spades.
Okay, yeah. Now, we have some other verses as far as this unstable. And I think this would describe Parminder. It's James 1, verse 6. It says, but let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. And that definitely describes Parminder, his vacillation on his beliefs. Teaching, being the leader initially in this movement, of giving arguments for the 25-20 in a series of 20 videos, and then completely repudiating everything he taught in those videos. We also have talking about the natural man, right? So this would be Reuben, having eyes full of adultery and that cannot cease from sinning, beguiling unstable souls and heart that they have exercised with covetous practices, cursed children. It goes on and on that one. So that would describe Parminder as well. And we also have 2 Peter 3:16. And it says, as also in his epistles, Paul's epistles, speaking in them of things in which are some things hard to be understood, and which they that are unlearned and unstable rest, as they do also the other scriptures, unto their own destruction. So this is definitely what Parminder has done. He has rested, twisted the scriptures to suit his purposes. So we can then take the numbering of Reuben and we can apply it to Parminder. So when we go to the last day of the General Conference session in 1888, just as we did with Zebulun the last day of the General Conference in 1863, going to July 18th, and we count the 46,500 days from the numbering of that tribe, it brings us to Parminder's ordination on February 27th, 2016. And so we have something that's very precise. Now, we know that Parminder starts in 2012, but by 2016, after being basically called a fanatic by Jeff, he's going to restore that relationship with FFA And he's now going to be put in charge of the one to organize the movement. Now, it's going to be 1,279 days to August 29th, 2019, when Parminder's rebellion comes full bore in by the symbols of Baal Peor, right? So we're going to see that Baal Peor is connected to Parminder. Now, I want to point this next point out is, now, I know this thing's, we're going to have to go through them a few times. Now, if I go back to the scriptures, the numbering that happens in Numbers 26 occurs after what event? So you go to Numbers 26 and they're going to take a census again. So they did the numbering in chapters 1 and 2. What is this following according to Numbers 26 verse 1? It came to pass after the plague that the Lord spake unto Moses. Okay, so what is this plague? What is the event? Anybody? So if we go back to Numbers 25, we have Baal Peor. And we've already recognized that this represents Parminder's rebellion. We have Zimri, the son of Salu, the prince of a chief house among the Simonians, or the Simonites, I mean, and the name of the Midianitish woman that was slain was Cosby, the daughter of Zur. He was head over a people and of a chief house in Midian, right? And how are they going to be slain? Anybody remember?
That's Phinehas running a
spear. Right?
Yep. Go ahead.
They were speared right through, back to belly and back.
Yeah, so they were speared right through their bellies when they were caught in the act. And those that died in the plague were 24,000. So we have a whole bunch of things here that we still have to address. Can we look at 24,000 as a symbol, because it's a numbering of a people? Does it represent time? Or is it just a symbol?
It could easily represent time.
Yeah. So I think it represents time. And we're not really sure where to place it yet. But we would have to say that it represents time. It represents something. And just like we know that 10,000 is going to represent time. So we know that we have this, the rebellion of Baal Peor, and then in the next chapter, we're going to have this numbering, and it's going to come to pass after this plague that occurs because of the rebellion, right? So, where is it here? And right, because remember, Phinehas, he's going to, what is it that happens here? I think it talks about this somewhere else, maybe. I think they talk about this in Deuteronomy. So I'm not going to look into this in detail right now, but they're going to, what does Phinehas do? Maybe I should talk about it. So he's going to, so he's going to kill, this is, the plague is going to be stayed because of him killing these women. So, and Moses said unto the judges of Israel, slay ye every one his men that were joined unto Baal Peor. And behold, one of the children of Israel came and brought unto his brethren a Midianitish woman in the sight of Moses. So does it describe this plague other than that they're going to slay these people? So it doesn't really say much about the plague itself here. And Paul, when he refers to it in 1 Corinthians 10:8, he says that 23,000 died. And just here, this is the translators of the King James. It says, Paul reckons only 23,000. Moses includes in the 24,000 he names the 1,000 men who were slain in the consequence of the judicial examination in Numbers 25:4, as well as the 23 who died of the plague, while St. Paul only refers to the latter. Take the heads of the people and hang them up against the sun, that the fierce anger of the Lord may be turned away from Israel. And Moses said unto the judges of Israel, slay every one his men that were joined unto Baal Peor. So, anyway, that's what's said there. So if we're going to look at Parminder, he's definitely, it's the rebellion at Baal Peor. And we could see on that chart there, we have 1,279 days between Parminder's ordination and his rebellion. Now, if we go back to February 16th, we could add 11 days to this 1,279. And why would we go back to February 16th, 2016? Is February 16th a symbol? Yeah, 6 times 6 times 6. So if we go back to February 16th, 2016, 11 days before February 27, that would be 1,290 days to August 29th, 2019. I'm not saying we have to do that. And then we're going to have a further 465 days to December 6th. Now you can see the 465. We have 46,500 days for Reuben. Is December 6, 2020, a continuation of Parminder's rebellion? December 6, 2020 is the declaration. So are those that wrote the declaration, are they in sympathy with Parminder's rebellion? That is,
yes.
Yeah. Because do they reject July 18, 2020?
Yes.
And that's part of Parminder's rebellion, because what specifically happens on August 29th, 2019? It's 220 days, or 220 years, pardon me, from the death of Pope Pius VI. And so it's the restoration of papal persecution. And who's being persecuted? And why are they being persecuted?
Because they will not submit to the authority of the Pope.
Yeah, and that's Stephen, Odilio, and John Mark.
Right.
They won't recant their belief in July 18th. So this movement is given 465 days, 1/100th of the days of Reuben. And then on December 6th, they're going to fulfill that prophecy. They're going to reject the July 18th on the same basis that Parminder rejected it. And they're going to enact the same sort of papal spirit in that rejection, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Now, this is a little more involved chart, but I'm not going to go into all this. I went through some of this before, but I want and I had some mistakes in it when I presented it on Friday, a couple of little typos, or got some of the dates switched around. But this is October 22nd, 1844. And we're going to use the tribe of Dan as an example. So I'm just going to show you this chart. So here we have a chart of the numbering of the tribes. And what we see here is we have the tribes, and then we have numbers 1 and 2, the numbers that are given for those tribes, and then numbers 26. And we have the difference between those. So did I do that the correct way? So I should have the minuses as pluses and the pluses as minuses. So I guess the way that I would look at it is they lose. The difference here is 2,770 between Reuben. But I'm going to go down to Dan. Now, Dan, when it's numbered in Numbers chapter 2, is 62,700. And then when he's numbered in Numbers 26, he's 64,400. So he's decreased or increased, pardon me. So I just got to switch my math around. I got to do this while I'm thinking of it. This will just switch the signs the right way. Okay, so we can see that the Dan is going to increase by 1,700. Now, Dan, what does Dan represent? What's his blessing? We know his name means a judge.
His name is a judge, but he's also a backbiter.
Right. So Genesis 49:16 says, Dan shall judge his people as one of the tribes of Israel. Dan shall be a serpent by the way, an adder in the path that biteth the horse's heels, so that his rider shall fall backward. So Dan is involved in backbiting, gossip, rumors, character assassination. Correct?
Yep.
And so what we're going to see here when we look at the line of Dan, we're going to be connected to, we're going to connect this not particularly to Parminder, but to this movement. So this movement, its main reference goes back to October 22nd, 1844. That's where we find our origins. That's the Day of Atonement. This is the time of the third angel's message. And if we count Dan, 62,700 days brings us to June 22nd, 2016. Now, June 22nd is the symbol of FFA. And 2016 is when Stephen and I are at the School of the Prophets. I don't have a specific event on that day, but I do have the symbol. So Stephen and I are studying together in Arkansas. We're there for 3 months. Heidi's there as well. And so June 22nd, as far as I can figure, it may be the date that I actually figured out, because it's the right day of the week. I'm just not sure if it's 1 week later or this week, when I had figured out Ezekiel, where I had the dream where I could show that Ezekiel was using two different ways of counting, a fall to fall and a spring to spring calendar. But I can't prove that. I don't have a documentation for that. But it doesn't really matter, just because the symbol there of FFA, that's where we are at the School of the Prophets. And then we're going to have Dan in Numbers 26, 1,700 days, representing the increase of 1,700 soldiers. And that's going to end on February 16th, 2021. Now, February 16th, 2021 is a symbol again. But this symbol in 2021, I don't have some event that occurs on that date specifically. We know that it's going to be connected somewhat to the events of January 6th. But we just have it there as a symbol in 2021. Now, we do have February 16th, 2022, 1 year later, in which this, it's going to be the first time that they publish after they started giving my Zoom address on the Three Angels messages, emails. It's going to be the first time that I'm not included. So anybody who has those emails can check that. If you have the Three Angels messages fellowship emails where they notify you the week before, my contact is in that email, and on February 16, 2022, it's no longer there. So it's there as a symbol, this February 16th, 2021. But we can see that it relates to these symbols that have to do with this movement. So, and this movement, basically, it's in this period of time that I have this experience of having my character judged, which it still continues. Now, February 16th, 2021 is also 14,800 days from my conversion. So there's symbols along in that one as well, but I'm not going to go into all of these different connections. And there's also this 213 days. So these are all things which I just don't have time to go into. I'm going to try to put this all together for people. Now, I just want to address a couple of other points. So so these ones here, I think this is correct. Yes. So let's look at the one on the bottom. Now, this is just two other ones. We can also take Dan, and we can go from August 15th, 1844. And this is going to bring us to December 10th, 2020. Now, December 10th, 2020 is 4 days after the December 6th declaration. But it's also the date of a letter that Dwight sends to Parminder and Jason regarding what happened on December 6th and the events leading up to it. So if we go from the midnight cry symbol in 1844, we can take the number of Dan from Numbers 26, 64,400 men represents 64,400 days. And this connects us to, yeah, so Iran just wants to point out to February 22, 2024. I guess I have to show you this. So on the top, this is the Battle of Plattsburgh. This is a parallel to 9/11, because from September 11th, 1840 to September 11th, 2001 is 187 years, right? Just add them together. 1814 plus 187 is 2001. But also from September 11th, we can take Judah from Numbers 6 and Judah's from Numbers 1 and use these spans of time. And they'll give us December 10th, 2018, which is while I'm at the School of the Prophets in 2018. And there's stuff connected with this, but I'm not going to go into that. And then the difference between Judah is 1900 days. And so Judah also goes to February 22nd, 2024. That's a date in the future, a symbolic date. We don't have anything attached to it. And if I go from the General Conference of November 4th, 1888, we can take Issachar, and it will lead us to this February 22nd, 2024 date. So that's why this date is down here. It's just connecting December 10th as a symbol. But this is connected with September 11th, 1814. Now, September 11th, 1816 is the 2 year anniversary of the Battle of Plattsburgh, in which William Miller begins his series of studies, a 2 year period of studies from 1816 to 1818, in which at the end of the 2 year periods of studies, he's going to conclude that Christ is coming in about 25 years, about the year 1843. And you can see that there's a symbol here, 10,200. Now 10,200, so I'm gonna have to go over here. So you can start to see the complexity of this. If I go to the tribe of Benjamin, that's the difference, that's how much Benjamin gains between the two censuses, or censi. So that happens to fit into this structure here. So if I go from September 11th, 1816, it's 10,200 days to August 15th, 1844. So you can see even these differences between the tribes can be spans of time that connect things. And then I count the tribe of Dan. So this is the tribe of Benjamin. It's not Judah or Dan. It's just the tribe of Benjamin's difference that fits in here. And this goes to December 10th, 2020, to that letter. Now, what I want people to see, oh, I didn't switch screens here. I'll go back here. So you can see there's the September 11th, 1816, the 10,200, which comes from Benjamin. And it connects then the number of Judah and the number of Dan, Judah in Numbers 1, Dan in Numbers 26, to confirm or affirm this December 10th, 2020 date. And any thoughts on this? I mean, it may seem a little bit esoteric to people. And see, I haven't even worked everything. Like some of the things I found connections, but I haven't had time to draw out the charts. You know, for instance, if we go to Simeon, so I'm going to go back here. And we go to Simeon. Simeon's going to have 59,300 in Numbers chapter 2 or Numbers chapter 1. And in Numbers 26, it's going to be 22,200. He's going to lose 37,100 men. Now, why does Simeon lose so many men? Why is the next generation of Simeon so much lower? I mean, that's the most that any tribe loses. Dwight, do you have any thoughts on that? Mike's on.
Not right now, no.
Okay. So Simeon is singled out here. And that would be due to the numbers that were killed in these plagues. So can't remember exactly the details of this. Yeah, but the point that I'm bringing out is this 22,200 is a symbol of February 22nd. Does that make sense?
Makes sense to me.
Okay, that makes sense to you. And it could be because of the rebellion at Baal Peor that mostly Simeonites were killed, because Zimri is from what tribe?
I'm supposing he was from the tribe of the Simeon, but Simeon was also involved with the slaughter at Shechem and the breaking of the covenant with Shechem.
Yes.
I think it was Simeon.
But here specifically, we're going to have probably a large number of Simeonites that are actually being killed in this plague. I mean, if there's 23,000 people killed, It could be that a large number of those are Simeonites. Doesn't say this specifically, but it's going to be Zimri, who's the son of Salu, a prince of a chief among the Simeonites. So Salu's a prince. At least I assume that it is. It could be that Zimri was a prince of a chief, a prince of a chief house among the Simeonites. So I think that's the house is Salu's house. But it's his death that's going to stop the plague. And so it could be that a large number of Simeonites are killed. So, you know, we only have a few minutes left. But in looking at this, here is my conclusion. And we're going to have to deal with this tomorrow. But just dealing with these numbers that you see in front of us. Each one of these numbers will represent spans of time connecting significant events in Millerite history and our history, or sometimes significant events in our history alone. The differences between these tribes also are periods of time that are part of a structure. And it's a very complicated structure. I've only shown you a part of what I found, because some of it I just can't remember. I have to go back and look at it again. But these are all these pieces of the puzzle that fit together in this sort of matrix that shows that this is all, that each one of these periods, each one of these tribes is a period of time that we can place in our history. Also, the differences that exist. Now, I just want to point out one more, because this one is interesting and to me particularly. Should be most interesting to Stephen, but I'm just going to try to do this really briefly. The tribe of Asher gains 11,900 men. Does anybody know what 11,900 is? Where we have seen this. I mean, we've seen this in the past. It's a period of 32 years and 7 months. So I have to put that in the chart. I need to make a chart showing that how long each of these are. But it's 32 years and 7 months. And we had used it in connection here. So I'll go back to my charts with our understanding of the prophecy of Revelation chapter 9. So let me see if I can find it here. So what you're looking at here is a chart, and what it is the Islamic calendar lines up with our calendar. That is, if you're familiar with Ramadan ends up being 10 days roughly earlier every year, because the Islamic calendar has a year of 354.37 days. That is, it's not 365. They don't have the leap year like the lunar calendar, the solar lunar calendar of the Jews does. So in order for this cycle to come around, for them to cover 365 days, because they're losing 10 every year, it takes 32 years and 7 months. And that period, more specifically, is 11,900 days and 1190 minutes. So it's a really interesting period of time. Now, if you put them all together, that is, if we put 12 of these periods, it ends up being a period of 391 years. That is, 11,900 days is 391 months. And so obviously, if you multiply 391 months by 12, you're going to get 391 years, which is going to be 142,809 days, 20 hours, and 1 minute. Now, in the Islamic calendar, that's going to be 403 Islamic years. That is, 391 months are months on our calendar. 391 months on our calendar is 403 months on the Islamic calendar. So I don't mean to confuse you. The main point here is we have this symbol of 11,900 and also the symbol of 1190. So what I noticed yesterday, because I was struggling with all this stuff and I went for a nap, and then as soon as I went lay down for a nap, I noticed something, so I had to get up and figure this out. So I'm just going to go one more time to the whiteboard and show this here. So it's just going to take a brief moment. So what we have here is 9/11. Now, if I count 11,900 years before 9/11, I'm going to come to this date. And this date happens to be Stephen Jameson's birthday. I mean, more specifically, his birth. Now, the thing that's amazing is we never noticed this, because Stephen knows about the 11,900 days. And you can see, if you even just simply count it, this is going to be 32 years, is going to bring you to 2001. And then you count 7 months, February 11th to March, April, May, June, July, August, September, 7 months, and that brings you to 9/11. Now, but 11-9, what does this represent?
Isn't that the inverse of 9/11?
Yeah, so it can represent 9/11 or 11-9. It can represent November 9th, right? So if I put here, now this could be any 11-9. But if I count, instead of 11,900 days, I count 1,190 days. So I take that other portion. What date do you think I arrive at?
That Stephen's birthday.
Stephen's birthday. Now, it doesn't matter what year you do this in. So there's something that I had noticed as well. So I'm just going to do it this way. So this 11-9 could be anywhere, but I'm going to put here Stephen's birthday and my birthday. So so Stephen's born here February 11th. 1969, and I'm born over here, February 6th, 1963. Now, the number of days between us is 2,197 days, which is 13 times 13 times 13 days. Now, if I count back here, 1,109, this will be November 9th. 1965, right? Because November 9th, it doesn't matter what year, you count from that date, you'll come to February 11th. Now this is 1,007 days. That is 1,007 plus this equals this, right?
Okay.
This is the symbol of the 10th day of the 7th month. Now, the interesting thing for me was to count from this date here,
this November 9th date, so I'm just going to put it up here. That's between mine and Stephen's birthdays in this structure. And I'm going to use the difference between, I believe it's the tribe of, which tribe was it? I'll look at it right after. But I'm going to count from this date. And what I'm going to count is it's 20,500. So one of the tribes, the differences between it is 20,500. So I'm taking one of those differences and I'm making it as a span of time. And so this is going to come to December 25th, 2021. Okay. Now this, of course, becomes really esoteric. It's not something that, you know, on the surface we can see. So that means from my birthday is 21,507 days, but I'm just taking that November 9th, 1965, in between mine and Stephen's structure, mine and Stephen's births, and putting it on there. And the thing is, I just looked at that as a whim. I just said, well, if I count back to November 9th, how many days is it? And I looked at that 20,500, which is the difference between Manasseh's two counts. So if you look between Manasseh, here you can see there's 20,500 days. And so that becomes, again, a period of time. And so all of these periods of time, and I've looked at all of them already, and I can find connections between all of them, either to symbolic dates or to actual events. And so it's just going to be taking all of these spans. So what I have is I have 36 different spans of time, correct?
Right.
And all of these fit into a matrix that connect our history from the Millerite movement all the way up to 2030. So that seems pretty remarkable, doesn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. It's just being able to put this in a way that people can understand it and to present it logically and consistently. Because the one thing that you don't want to do is just confuse people with a bunch of numbers and they have no idea what you're talking about, though I know I do that all the time. But we can see that even just in these examples, that they connect to our history, to the people in this movement. And there are some that I've made connections to dates, but I don't have a person attached to that yet. That is, I have the date December 25th, 1969. I don't know who was born on that date, but that's part of our structure. Symbolically, December 25th is a symbol, but the fact that it might be somebody's birthday in this movement, and I'm not saying it has to be, but it definitely could be. And so all of these dates, whether they're symbolic or they're actual, so they're, some of these dates are like March 27th, you know, in 1873 or something like that. Well, it doesn't, we don't have an event on that date. I mean, I think it's March 27th, actually, 1906, fits in one of these structures, one of these spans of time. So that's the thing that I'm facing right now, is in struggling through all of this, these numbers, as much as I enjoy it in some levels, it takes a lot of time. You know, if I had a computer program that could just automatically match them up for me, you know, you just put in all the significant dates in our movement, all the symbols, and see how they all line up. But I have to do this manually. So any questions about this?
Just a lot to consider.
Yes. And the main point that we saw here in the study so far is that this is addressing
Parminder and his error in Judges chapter 4. And so God gave us this information at this time so that we could confirm our understanding of Judges chapter 4, but he gave it through Odilio, right? That is, he used Odilio's study to draw our attention to the fact that these numbers of people can represent days. And it can show that Parminder's message and those that have joined with Parminder in rejecting July 18th are part of that nation that has been allowed to test and prove us. And the question is, are we going to pass that test? Are we going to heed the message of chronology that's attached to July 18th, etc.? And we're going to see then that, because we're going to look at this more tomorrow, we'll go through and look at the story of Deborah and try to put this on a line. Barak, Deborah, and Sisera, and Jabin, and try to understand that message, what it is, how it's illustrating a history from basically 2012 until 2023. Primarily 2012 to 2019, but also the history after. So Iran asks a question, what do you mean by combined 3915?
I'm asking him because he quotes the verse.
Okay. You're asking Iran. Okay.
Yeah. Excuse me. Oh, characters. Characters of Zimri?
Of the verse.
Characters, right? Of the verse.
So when we count the sum of this verse, Numbers 25:14, the name of the Israelite that was slain, even that was slain with the Midianitish woman, was Zimri, the son of Salu, the prince of the chief house among the Simeonites. That is, we have this combination. So you take on, if you go to palmoni.org, Iran has a program there that is the Bible indexer. It's the King James Version Bible indexer. Yeah. If you type in web.palmoni.org/King James Version KJ.
I can't, you're going way too fast.
Okay.
It said Rev, R-E-V,
yeah, I'll just,
as in virgin. Or...
I'll just put the link here.
Yeah. Just...
So if you go here, you will find that links you to this indexer. You can also just go to palmoni.org and you'll find the link to it. And then what he does is he goes to Numbers 25. So I'll just show you here. Here's what it looks like.
Is that the entire verse, like all the words in the, all of the letters in the verse in English? Is it in Hebrew? This is
Number 25, verse 14. So I go to verse 14 here, and it will show you, it's the fifth, the reverse verse. So the rev, what does this mean? So the Bible verse, it's, I don't even know how to understand. So it's the fifth verse from the end of that chapter. Right, and it goes through, and then it'll say the Bible verse. It's the 4,486th Bible verse. It's 26,617 from the end of the Bible. It's the 881st verse of the book, right, etc. And then it gives you a gematria. So it takes the chapter is 10,000. Reverse Bible, that's okay, here it is. The sum is 1555, and the reverse sum, that is using the numbers in reverse, so Z becomes 1, or Z if you're American, you know, etc. Y becomes the number 2, and then we have the sum is of that. And then you have the combined. The combined sum is 3591. So, and what's 3591? What's the significance here? It's just all of the numbers of 391.5, right?
Right. Yep.
Okay. So that's, and then characters times 27. Is that the word characters times 27?
No, I'm just saying that the other way you can get to the gematria sum is just multiplying the number of characters.
Oh, okay. So if you just multiply the number of characters, then you'll get to that. Okay. So anyway, I know that's a roundabout way, but these are things we look at. Now, the problem, and again, I want to stress this, the problem that people have is this becomes very difficult to understand. So we have all of these different numbers. And for people to understand the significance of what we're doing, some of these things are very significant. That is, they're just an interest, some of the things. And some of the things are major issues or major points, major arguments. And I always use this example. You know, the 46 years representing from 1798 to 1844 as being the building of the temple. You know, we have the 46 years in the Bible. We have, of course, that structure. But we'll say there's 46 genes in the human genome. Is that a major argument? Are we basing it upon the fact that there's 46 genes in the human genome and we're the temple of God? So that means 46 years have to be from 1798 to 1844. Is that a major argument? That's the question.
It should be.
Well, it isn't. That is, we didn't base it on that. It's what we would call a supporting argument. That is, we establish something based upon a study of the Bible, and then we notice other things that support it, but those aren't the way that we came to that conclusion. That is, we don't just go and find some Bible verse and it adds up to some number, and now that number becomes a date or something on a line, right? We can look at and see these symbols. And so sometimes these can sort of lead us a little bit off track. That is, we can go really deep into some of these things. Now, I watched Colin's study yesterday in the morning. And I felt that he was doing that in the sense that he started to lose people, just like I tend to lose people, because he started adding a lot of detail. At least that was my perception. And some of the things were a little bit of a stretch. That is, they weren't really that significant. And they're not wrong. Like, he didn't do something wrong in my view. But he didn't explain some things very well. And people watching it, and this is the problem that I have too, so I'm criticizing myself as well. So if I bring in too much detail, the main point can be lost. In a sense, in this study, it can, but I'm trying to show how complex it is and that it's not simple to present all of this light. And so the question is, well, why should we consider it? Why should we care about Stephen's birthday, that it's 1190 days prior to 9/11? Is it important?
Well, he is a major part of this movement, and it fits in with our lines, with the chronology.
Yeah, but is it a distraction from us presenting this message?
Well, some people might say, if they're looking at it in the carnal, oh, he's just trying to exalt himself, or Theodore is just trying to exalt Stephen, mm-hmm. or vice versa.
Yeah. So somebody asks a question or makes a statement, I guess. It's sort of I guess there is a question here. He says, I think the discussion in terms of the broad ways in which these symbols can be applied is off topic. Now, this was a study I did back on the 777 chiasm where the Mayan calendar and my anniversary and when I met Heidi and Heidi's birthday and my birthday are all tied in, right? He says, as a listener, what relevance is your date of birth, your new wife's age, or a number of years of a previous marriage relevant? Seeing you brought up your former marriage, was death the separator, or are you legally now married in terms of Bible requirements? I don't see how the current discussion in this segment could be taken to any SDA and be accepted. And that's, in some ways, these are fair questions, though maybe asking about whether I'm now legally married, because he may have the impression that the only grounds for remarriage is the death of a spouse, which Ellen White is quite
clear. That's like it.
Yeah, that's not the only reason that you can get married, right? So we know, based on Jesus's words and Ellen White's counsel, that people can get remarried who were divorced, depending on the circumstances of that divorce. Obviously, if I initiated a separation and divorce and then get remarried, I wouldn't have grounds to get remarried. But, you know, those are very personal things. But so in some ways, that's maybe not a fair question to ask. But as far as the other part of it, here's how I respond. I would think that my date of birth is relevant, just as anyone's is, if it relates to the lines. That is, I did not put my birth date into the lines. It just happened to be there, just as Heidi and I happened to meet on December 21st, 2012, 1,872,000 days from the start of the Mayan calendar on August 11, minus 3113. This happened to be 777 days prior to my 52nd birthday. 52 times 360 is 18720. Again, is not something I could create. This just happened to be part of a structure that we already had arrived at. Again, I could not foresee this. I realize that you may not be familiar with all the information and the relevance of these dates. I do not think I expect someone to merely accept it. I expect them to examine it. Based on this information, I wrote Jeff Pippinger and asked him to consider whether the July 18, 2020 prediction would fail. As the person who arrived at the date, it makes sense that God would show me that the prediction would fail. Again, I'm not sure what I can do about this information since it is part of the lines. What do you suggest I do? Well, he hasn't answered that yet. But this is the question that I ask. What can I do? See you, William. Because I can't change, you know, the date of my birth if it becomes relevant in the lines, or if Stephen's birthday becomes relevant in the lines, or some other person's birthday becomes part of the structure. And that they're establishing things that we already know. Then we would just have to accept it. Now, the question is, should I present it? I mean, that's probably the question. Could I have presented the 777 chiasm without mentioning that my birthday was February 6th and that I turned 52 on February 6th, 2015? I couldn't have, because that information of me being 52 was completely relevant in that it gave the symbol of 18720, and it also divided that 777 days into 504 days and 273 days, just as it did with the 777 from November 9th to December 25th, 2021. So there's no way that I could have left out that information. It would just be impossible. It wouldn't make it relevant then. That date would have no significance. It wouldn't tie us to the July 18, 2020 prediction. So that's why I have to present some things. So I know I went way over time, but hopefully people can help me with this in trying to, as we go through these studies, that we can find ways to present these things simply. So let's close with a word of prayer, unless somebody has something important they want to add. Okay. Dear Father in heaven, again, we are thankful for this study. We pray that you can be with each person throughout this week and help us in this study. We ask for your angels to continue to watch over us and that we can follow in the path that you lead us upon. Be with us now, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.